Dave, good morning. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning. I do have to say, though, that another nickname for Mr. Cohen would be Runica.
Okay. Instead of Hanukkah, Runica?
Maybe.
Okay.
That's maybe. All right. I'm trying.
Yeah, you're trying to be a topper instead of saying, boy, I love that, Dan. The Rosh Hashanah would have been nice, but okay.
Yeah, Rosh Hashanah is better. Okay. Rosh Hashanah is better.
summarize your column that you wrote on The Nation.
No, absolutely. Yesterday was a historic day, not just in the National Football League, but in the history of activism in sports. We've never, ever seen anything like this in terms of the sheer number of players. And it's worth looking at and identifying why exactly this took place, like taking a step back and saying, how is it that we had something like 200 NFL players take part in a form of protest? And I think that the best way to understand it is understanding the brotherhood that exists in National Football League locker rooms, or the solidarity that exists. And also we need to understand that Donald Trump, who never played football, did not understand the lengths of the brotherhood and solidarity that does exist. What I think took place was that Donald Trump was in front of his audience in Huntsville, Alabama, and he really has a lizard brain that is directly attuned to some of the worst impulses of his audience. And I think he looked at that audience and he said, you know, I'm going to go after black dissenting NFL players. They will be isolated and I will have people on my side. And what he did not expect was that there were not just NFL players, but coaches and owners who saw it as an almost I am Spartacus moment, that an attack on one is an attack on all. And when Trump took it, you know, talking extemporaneously, when he took it to things like calling for people to be fired, using the presidential pulpit to call for people to be fired, for using the phrase SOB and saying it all out there. I mean, I think you know this, Dan. I certainly know this from working on this book with Michael Bennett of the Seahawks, that the position of the mom in the NFL locker room is pretty special.
Yep.
And
yep.
Pretty sacred. Mm-hmm. And a lot of these players, even though a lot of us say SOB and we don't think of it as a direct attack on somebody's mother, for these players, it's like, oh, Donald Trump just talked about your mom, which is like talking about my mom, which means he's talking about Penny Bennett, the mother of Michael and Martellus Bennett, who, by the way, was a public school teacher for over 20 years and one of the dearest people I've ever met. So it becomes this thing that then got highly personalized in NFL locker rooms, to the point of which not only players, but owners had to answer the question that Charles Woodson, I thought, raised so poignantly with when he said, this is which side are you on Sunday?
How can the league handle this, juggle this? It's a business, and it feels like no matter what they do, you're going to alienate, upset some side of the fan base here.
Yeah, I mean, the fact that it's a business, I think, is one of the big reasons why so many NFL owners issued statements and stepped up, because Donald Trump did not only attack the players, he really attacked the league. You know, and when you call to boycott the league, when you call for people to walk out, and when you also take on the NFL's rule changes to try to handle the issue of traumatic brain injury and say that it's ruined the game and the game has gotten soft, I mean, you're talking not just about something that I know tears at the hearts of people in the NFL when they see older players come back to visit and they're incapacitated, but you're also going after what is like the greatest existential threat to the future of this multi-billion-dollar business. The things that keep Roger Goodell and these owners up at night is really, what will this game look like in 20 or 30 years? And that's what all of this is about. So I think what they realized is like, wow, because Trump went super divisive on this issue, we're going to alienate somebody. So where do we stand right now? There's no neutrality right now, because the president didn't just call out these players. He called out our entire league. So it's which side are you on Sunday? And the owners, I think they were boxed in. And they made, including Bob Kraft, made the only, you know, Trump's best or perhaps only friend. They made the decision that they had to make, which is, okay, maybe we were part of this audience, but let's have faith in the fact that we are still the most popular sport in the United States. Let's have faith in the fact that ratings across the board in sports are down. So it's not like people are leaving the NFL because of these protests. That's an utterly false narrative. And let's have faith in the fact that the games will get better as the season goes on, which I thought yesterday really did prove out. Far better product than the first 2 weeks, and hope we can just ride this out.
I'm wondering, though, if you go back 14 months ago when Colin Kaepernick did this, and when he started to do it, nobody noticed it. Then it started to gain a little speed there, and then people thought he'd never get in a game. Then he got into a game, and then he actually put up some decent numbers. But then I fast forward to the summer and the beginning of this season. If somebody picked up Colin Kaepernick and he was on a team, I wonder if we would have gotten anywhere near where we are now. That it almost felt like everybody was waiting. Why doesn't he get a job? And then if he got a job, then this was going to take a little bit of the steam out of it, and maybe it would go away. Do you think that timeline is fair?
Yes, absolutely. I've given this so much thought. Colin Kaepernick not being in the league was the match, and Donald Trump poured gasoline all over it. If Colin Kaepernick is in the league, maybe Donald Trump still pours gasoline, but it would be unclear about how aflame it would be, because the players already had it inside them that something was very wrong with Colin Kaepernick not being in the NFL, because it strikes at the heart of what they're told about the National Football League, that it's a meritocracy, and if you're out there, it means you're the best. And the other thing I can tell you, Dan, from my own reporting, is that last year, even if Colin Kaepernick's message about criminal justice and police brutality did not resonate with every player, even if only a handful of players took a knee or protested during the anthem, his courage in doing it week in, week out, and his reputation in the league, I mean, was platinum plated. I mean, that's why the 49ers voted to give him their Courage Award. That's why coaches like John Harbaugh, who was a Trump supporter, spoke out for Colin Kaepernick and said that he belongs in the league. I mean, his reputation, independent of the politics, was so burnished last year that to not see him on a team was something that really, I think, bothered so many players. And then players like Michael Bennett, like the Cleveland Browns, like Marshawn Lynch, like Malcolm Jenkins, they kept that flame alit, even if it was just embers heading into this season. This idea, just embers. And then Trump came in and he thought to himself, you know, this, I'm going to attack Malcolm Jenkins. I'm going to attack Michael Bennett. And that's the other thing that Trump did not understand, because he doesn't understand the NFL. And this is something that even the most right-wing coaches and executives in the NFL understand. And that's that players like Malcolm Jenkins and Michael Bennett, they may have politics that they disagree with, but they're also the most respected people in the locker room. They're the most eloquent people. They're the people that the people in the locker room rally around. They're the people who are credits to their organization and to their team. I was at the Seattle game last week, first home game for the Seahawks. And they made sure that Michael Bennett was the first person to come out of the locker room, no helmet on, to greet every player who came out. They had Michael Bennett in the middle of the huddle, you know, the Drew Brees-style guy who's in the middle psyching everybody up and as everybody moves side to side. They gave that position to Michael Bennett because they know what he means to that locker room, independent of politics. And that's something Donald Trump clearly did not understand. I think he overstepped. I think that's why he was backtracking ferociously yesterday about the question of boycotting the NFL. And I think that, you know, we should look at yesterday in a lot of respects as a victory for free speech and dissent in the face of having a president of the United States calling for people to lose their jobs. And that terrifies me. If Trump had did that, if Barack Obama had done that, I don't care. Abraham Lincoln, I would be in front of the House with a picket sign, because there's no way someone in that position should be calling for anybody to lose their job in this country or using that kind of language to refer to people's mothers.
Dave, thank you. We appreciate it. Thanks for your time.
Thank you, sir.
That's Dave Zirin, sports editor of The Nation, host of the Edge of Sports podcast.
The Dan Patrick Show, weekday mornings on Audience.